Simon & Schuster Audio presents Girl in Ice by Erica Ferencik. Read by Vivienne Leheny. How shall the heart be reconciled to its feast of losses? Stanley Kunitz. In ice is the memory of the world. James Balog. 1. Seeing the name Wyatt Speaks in my inbox hit me like a physical blow. Everything rushed back. The devastating phone call, the disbelief, the image of my brother's frozen body in the Arctic wasteland. I shut my laptop, pasted a weak smile on my face. There would be no bursting into tears at school. Grief was for after hours. For the nightly bottle of Merlot, for my dark apartment, for waking on the couch at dawn, the blue light of the TV caressing my aching flesh. No, at the moment my job was to focus on the fresh, eager face of my graduate student as she petitioned for a semester in Tibet, a project in a tiny village deep in the Himalayas, accessible only via treacherous mountain passes on foot and maybe llama, all to decipher a newly discovered language. As I listened to her impassioned plea, trying to harness my racing heart, an old shame suffused me. The truth was, I'd never embarked into the field any place more frightening than a local graveyard to suss out a bit of old English carved into a crumbling stone marker. And even then, I made sure to go in broad daylight because dead people, even underground, frightened me too. Never had my curiosity about a place or a language and its people overridden my just-say-no reflex. Citing schedule conflicts, I'd declined a plum semester-long gig in the Andean mountains of Peru to study quipu, or talking knots, cotton strings of differing lengths tied to a cord carried from village to village by runners, each variation in the string signaling municipal facts, taxes paid or owed, births and deaths, notices of famine, drought, crop failure, plague, and so on. I'd even passed on the once-in-a-lifetime chance to deconstruct a language carved into the 2,000-year-old Longyo Caves in Kucho, China. Why? Anxiety. The crippling kind. I'm tethered to the familiar, the safe, or what I perceive as safe. I function normally in only a handful of locations. My apartment, most places on campus, excluding the football stadium, too much open space, the grocery store, my father's nursing home. During my inaugural trip to the new, huge, and sparkly Whole Foods, chilled out on a double dose of meds, a bird flew overhead in the rafters. All I could think was, when is it going to swoop down and peck my eyes out? I never went back. Ironically, I was the one with the power to give or withhold the stamp of approval for my students' research trips, as if I were any judge of risk and character. Watching the glistening eyes of the young woman before me, one of my favorite students, I stalled a few moments, tossing out a couple of insipid questions about her goals, an attempt to soak up her magic normalcy. No such luck. I signed off on her trip to Tibet, wondering, how does she see me, really? I knew she was fond of me. That casual wave of her silver-braceleted hand as she turned to leave, that look in her eye. I swear I caught a glint of pity, of disdain. It was like she knew my secret. Her teacher was a fraud. I'm a linguist. I can get by in German and most Romance tongues, and I've got a soft spot for dead languages, Latin, Sanskrit, ancient Greek. But it's the extinct tongues, Old Norse and Old Danish, that enrapture me. Languages reveal what it is to be human. This desire to make ourselves understood is primal. We make marks on paper, babble snippets of sound, then agree by way of miracle that these scribblings or syllables actually mean something, all so we can touch each other in some precise way. Sanskrit has 96 words for love, from the particular love of a new mother for her baby to one for unrequited romantic love, but it has twice as many for grief. My favorite is Soka Parayana, which means wholly given up to sorrow. A strange balm of a word, gently coming off my tongue. The words came easily for me. I tended to miss the patterns that were staring me in the face. The fact that my ex genuinely wanted out didn't hit me until divorce papers were served. The fact of my father passing from just old to genuinely ill with lung cancer and not here for much longer didn't sink in until I was packing up the family home and found myself on my knees in tears, taken down by dolor repentino, a fit of sudden pain. The stark realization that my twin brother, Andy, the closest person in the world to me, had been pulling away for months, came to me only after his death and at the very worst times, lecturing in an auditorium packed with students, conversing with the dean in the hallway. When it happened, these vicious, sudden, psychic stabs, I'd briefly close my eyes or turn away to cough, repeating to myself, Soka Parayana, Soka Parayana, until I could speak again. I felt safest in my office, alone with my books, charts, runic symbols, and scraps of old text. And when I deciphered a chunk of language, even a word, a thrill of understanding juddered up my spine. The distance between me and another human being, just for that moment, was erased. It was as if someone were speaking to me, and me alone. For 2 decades, these glimmers of connection had been enough to sustain me, but over time they began to lose their shine. These private revelations no longer fed me, warmed me like they had. I yearned to be drawn closer to the human heart, not through words, however telling or ingenious, but in the living world. At precisely 8 o'clock that night, the end of office hours, I got up and locked the door, squared my shoulders, smoothed my skirt, and sat back down. Outside my window, remorseless late August sun cast long shadows across the drought-singed grass of the quad. I clicked open my email. The subject line was blank, but then Wyatt had never bothered with niceties. My head pounded with end-of-summer session exhaustion. I was in no mood to hear from Professor Speaks about my brother, his fond recollections of mentoring Andy through the rigors of grad school, or even some funny thing Andy had said or done during their year together on the ice. I considered deleting the message without reading it, but a tingling buzzed my fingers. Something said, "Don't." Still, I resisted, until some darker knowledge swarmed up from the base of my spine, warning me it would be a terrible mistake not to open it. From wyatt.speaks@arcticgreenlandscience.org to vchesterfield@brookview.edu. Hey Val, I hope you're doing well, all things considered. Something's happened out here. We found a body in the ice out on Glacier 35A, a young girl. We were able to cut through the ice and bring her back to the compound. Val, she thawed out alive. Don't ask me to explain it, I can't. She's 8, 9 years old, I'm guessing, and she's talking pretty much nonstop, but in a language I've never heard before. Even Petok, our supply runner from Connock, had no idea, and he speaks Inuktun. Jean's stumped too, so we're both just keeping the girl fed and nodding our heads a lot and trying to figure out what to do next. I've pasted here one of her vocalizations. Maybe you can figure out what she's saying. You're the expert. Give it a try, then call me as soon as you can. And please, don't tell anyone about this. Wyatt. The MP3 stuttered across my screen like a city skyline. The girl thawed out alive? Sweat bloomed on my brow, even though the air conditioner was blasting. I got up, walked to my window, sat back down, checked the time, too early for a pill. I knocked back the remaining swallow of stale coffee in my mug, rattled open my file drawer, extracted a bottle of amaretto and filled the cup halfway. The sweet, warm alcohol hit my empty stomach fast.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.